வணக்கம். In a case of nerve injury, you are now prepared to do either a neurolysis, a nerve repair, a nerve grafting, or a nerve transfer, or even a vascularized nerve graft if necessary. But what if the patient is presented to you 3 years after sustaining an injury? You know that the motor end units would have undergone degeneration, but still it is important to provide some basic movements for function. Or imagine the patient has had a cerebral palsy and the injury sustained is in the central nervous system. Or imagine a situation where you have already done a nerve repair or nerve grafting with no results. These are the situations where tendon transfers come in. We shall discuss the different specific tendon transfers under the different nerve injuries. But in this video, we will be discussing the basic principles of all tendon transfers and the methods to be successful in the procedure where success directly converts to function. Before we proceed to learning about tendon transfers in the upper extremity, let us see how the development of the concept of tendon transfers took place. There were three phases in the development of this concept. The first was the work by Duchenne way back in 1867, who used faradic muscle stimulation to study the physiology of motion. With World War I came the second phase, when surprisingly Jones in 1916 and 1921 was working on the tendon transfers for radial nerve palsy in England, while Mayer in 1916 was working in Berlin, and Steindler in 1918 was working in the United States, and all these were going on almost simultaneously. These basic concepts that developed were strengthened and used during the World War II experience by Sterling Bunnell in 1946 and J.W. Littler in 1949. These concepts have strengthened since then, and now tendon transfers form a part of the routine management in upper extremity surgery. The actual definition of a tendon transfer is when a tendon of a functioning muscle is detached from its insertion and reattached to another tendon or bone to replace the function of a paralyzed muscle or injured tendon. So we need to remember that in a classical tendon transfer, the transferred tendon remains attached to its parent muscle with an intact neurovascular pedicle. The aim of a tendon transfer is to restore functional motion of the hand and not just a movement. So the transfer to be done depends on what functional movement is required. The indications for tendon transfers are to replace paralyzed muscle, which could be due to a nerve injury, either a peripheral nerve injury or a brachial plexus injury, high cervical quadriplegia, neurological diseases, or nerve repair with early transfer as an internal splint, or to replace an injured muscle tendon unit which could have been either ruptured or avulsed, or to achieve balance in a deformed hand which could be either as a result of cerebral palsy or a degenerative disease like rheumatoid arthritis, or even congenital anomalies like hypoplastic thumb. Having learnt the indications, before deciding on tendon transfers, we need to consider certain factors: the patient factors, the recipient factors, the donor factors, and secondary factors. Let us consider these one by one. Among the patient factors, the age must be considered. Tendon transfers may not be appropriate in extremes of age, mainly for the reason that the ability to understand the nature and the limitations of surgery, including the aesthetic goals, may not be complete. The second important patient factor is that they should be motivated enough to cooperate with post-operative physiotherapy. Now let us consider the recipient factors. The recipient here refers to the area where the tendon transfer is going to be done. The most important factor in the recipient area is that the tissue equilibrium, as described by Steindler and Boyes, should be achieved. This means that there should be no open wounds, there should be stable and supple soft tissues with no evidence of induration or edema, there should be a stable underlying skeleton, the area of action, that is the part that is going to move, should be sensate, and the joints to be powered must have a full passive range of movement. This corresponds to the S3M2R concept that I have described earlier in a video. Please click on the icon above to view that video. The absence of open wounds, stable and supple soft tissues with no induration edema corresponds to the S1. The necessity for a stable underlying skeleton corresponds to the S2. The requirement for sensation corresponds to S3, and the need for soft and supple and full passive range of movements of the joints corresponds to the M1 category. We have now seen the patient factors and the recipient factors. As far as the donor factors are concerned, we shall try to remember these donor factors by the mnemonic APOSLE. The most important player in the donor is the muscle. There are two characteristics of any muscle which are important. One is the excursion or the amplitude. The second is the strength or the power. Let us consider the first donor factor, the A in the mnemonic. The length through which a muscle can contract is its amplitude. This depends on the length of the muscle and the muscle fiber, but these two are not the same. Let us consider an example. The flexor carpi ulnaris muscle belly is 25 centimeters long. So, is the excursion of the muscle 25 centimeters? No. Why is that? If we dissect the flexor carpi ulnaris muscle, we will find that the fiber length is only 4 centimeters and the tendon is 21 centimeters long. The muscle fiber length is proportional to the excursion of the muscle. The flexor carpi ulnaris has a limited excursion of only 3.5 centimeters. This way, we need to remember that all the muscles have their own amplitude. It is easy to remember the 7-5-3 rule. That is, the finger flexors have an amplitude of approximately 7 centimeters. The finger extensors and the extensor pollicis longus have an amplitude of about 5 centimeters, and the wrist flexors and extensors have an amplitude of about 3 centimeters. The brachioradialis has an amplitude of about 20 to 30 millimeters. We need to remember this when we are matching a muscle to be transferred to the unit that is going to be replaced. Now let us consider an hypothetical tendon transfer. If I transfer the flexor carpi radialis to the finger flexors, I am transferring a muscle with an excursion of approximately 30 millimeters to replace a muscle with an excursion of 70 millimeters. If I do this, will the resultant finger movement be enough? Definitely not. On the other hand, if I transfer the flexor carpi radialis to the finger extensors, I am transferring a muscle with an excursion of about 30 millimeters to replace a muscle with an excursion of around 50 millimeters. Will it move enough? Well, almost. If it will be possible for me to increase the excursion of the flexor carpi radialis to a certain extent, I'll be able to get a good tendon transfer. This can be done by three techniques. The first is during the surgery, freeing the facial attachments to the donor tendons and dissecting the muscle almost completely, making sure that the neurovascular bundle is preserved. The second technique is to insert the tendon closer to the joint being moved. And the third technique is what is known as the tenodesis effect during active movement. Full extension of the fingers cannot be achieved when we do a transfer like this. However, if we flex the wrist joint, we get an additional movement of extension of the fingers by about 20 to 30 millimeters. This will achieve extension of the fingers. Now that we have understood the A of the donor factor, that is the amplitude of the muscle, we shall now go on to understanding the P, that is the power of the muscle. The tension that any muscle can develop is its innate strength. The muscle that is transferred may be too strong for the muscle that it is replacing, or it may be too weak for the muscle it is replacing. In both conditions, the transfer will fail. And it is the physiological cross-sectional area of the muscle which is proportional to the maximum tension that the individual muscle can produce. Any muscle can produce a force of 3.65 kg per square centimeter of its cross-sectional area. This potential force is maximal when the muscle is at its resting length, which is defined as the position midway between the length at maximum passive stretch and when it is fully contracted. We need to remember this point when we are adjusting the tension of the tendon transfer. As far as the upper limb is concerned, it is not necessary to remember the power of every single muscle that is present in the upper limb. What we need to understand is the comparative strength between the different muscles. For example, if we consider that the strength of the flexor carpi radialis, the wrist extensors, the finger flexors and the pronator teres is about 1. There are muscles that have twice the strength, that is the brachioradialis and the flexor carpi ulnaris, while some muscles have only half the strength of the flexor carpi radialis group, that is the finger extensors, and some muscles have only quarter the strength, that is the abductor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis longus, extensor pollicis brevis and the palmaris longus. So now, considering the amplitude of the muscle and the strength of the muscle, which is represented by the tension fraction, let us consider a few examples. Supposing we are transferring the flexor digitorum superficialis of the finger, which has a resting fiber length of 7 cm, that is amplitude of almost 7 cm, with a tension fraction of 2.0, to replace a lumbrical, which has a resting fiber length of 6.6 cm, but with a tension fraction of 0.2, we will find that the tendon transfer is much too strong and should not be done. Let us consider another example. The flexor carpi ulnaris has a resting fiber length of 3.5 cm with a tension fraction of 6.7. Suppose we use it to replace the flexor digitorum profundus, which has a resting fiber length of 6.6 cm and a tension fraction of only 3.0, we will find that this tendon transfer is too short but too strong and hence again not advised. Let us also consider this example. The pronator teres has a resting fiber length of 5.1 cm and a tension fraction of 5.5. The extensor carpi radialis brevis has an amplitude of 6.1 cm and a tension fraction of 4.2. So it is ideal and the pronator teres can be comfortably transferred to the extensor carpi radialis brevis to achieve a good function. On the other hand, if we consider transferring the pronator teres to the extensors of the fingers, we will find that the extensors of the fingers have an amplitude of 5.5, which is quite matching, but the tension fraction is only 1.7, hence it is not an ideal transfer. Having seen the innate strength of the muscle, we also need to consider the power of the muscle, which refers to the working capacity according to the MRC grading, M0 being no movement, M1 being flicker of movements and M5 being full power. This is important because transferred muscle loses at least one grade of strength. So only grade 5 muscles are satisfactory as donors for tendon transfer. If the muscle that is planned to be transferred is not yet of grade 5, the donor muscle strength should be maximized preoperatively. After considering the amplitude and the power of the muscle, we need to consider the O of this mnemonic, which stands for one tendon, one function. Transfer of one motor tendon unit to restore multiple functions will result in compromised strength and movement. The only exception is the use of a single motor to restore the same movement in more than one digit. Example, use of the extensor carpi radialis for claw correction in the EF4T procedure. Under this principle, the flexor carpi ulnaris or the flexor carpi radialis cannot be used to power wrist and finger extension or finger extension and thumb abduction, but it can be used to power the extension of all the fingers. The next factor is the S, which stands for synergistic muscle transfer. Synergistic muscles refer to those muscles that act together to perform a particular function or act together when a particular function is being performed. When muscles from these groups are used for the transfer, they are generally easier to retrain. For example, wrist flexion and finger extension are synergistic. So, the transfer of a wrist flexor for finger extensor is synergistic. But finger flexion and finger extension are not synergistic as they do not occur together. Hence, transfer of a finger flexor for a finger extensor is obviously not synergistic. To remember approximately which are the synergistic muscles, we can remember two groups of muscles. One is the fist group and the other is the open hand group. The fist group consists of wrist extensors, finger flexors, digital adductors, thumb flexors, forearm pronators and intrinsics. So, any of these muscles can be transferred to replace any of the others. And the open hand group consists of the wrist flexors, finger extensors, digital abductors and the forearm supinators. Similarly, within this group, tendon transfers can be done. But tendon transfers are not advisable between muscles of these two groups. Hence, it is important to use only synergistic muscles in tendon transfer to help retain the balance of the joints. Now we come to the next donor factor, the L of our mnemonic apostle. This L stands for the line of transfer. This should approximate the pull of the original tendon if possible, and acute angles should be avoided. Hence, a tendon transfer will work best if it passes in a direct line from the origin of the donor muscle to its new insertion. If there is a direction change, the force of the pull diminishes. Even a change of direction of 40 degrees will result in a clinically significant loss of force. An example would be the pronator teres to extensor carpi radialis brevis transfer, which can be done either as an end-to-end suturing or as an end-to-side transfer. The end-to-end transfer has a better function and force transfer rather than the end-to-side transfer. But obviously, the end-to-end transfer cannot be done in all patients, especially when you're doing an early transfer, because nerve recovery may occur and it is not prudent to cut the extensor carpi radialis brevis tendon. If a direction change is unavoidable, a smooth structure should be planned to act as a pulley, and this pulley should be smooth and allow gliding of the transferred tendon. That brings us to the last of the mnemonic apostle, represented by the letter E, which stands for expendability. This means that the tendon that is transferred must be of an expendable muscle. There are three important points to note here. The transfer must not cause loss of an essential function. The use of a muscle must not create an important new deficit. And thirdly, we need to remember that expendability is not absolute. When we say that the transfer must not cause a loss of an essential function, it means that there must be another muscle to do the job. For example, when we are transferring the pronator teres, the pronator quadratus is there to perform the function of pronation. Similarly, when transferring the extensor carpi radialis longus for EF4T procedure in ulnar nerve palsy, the extensor carpi radialis brevis and the extensor carpi ulnaris are already there to carry out the extension of the wrist. Similarly, when we say the use of a muscle must not create an important new deficit, we can quote the example of harvesting the flexor digitorum superficialis tendon of the finger as a donor for a tendon transfer, which may result in a recurvatum deformity at the level of the PIP joint in some cases. And when we say that expendability is not absolute, we can quote two examples. The ring finger flexor digitorum superficialis tendon may be used to correct metacarpophalangeal joint hyperextension, that is a claw deformity, in patients with a low ulnar nerve palsy, but it is not expendable in patients with a high ulnar nerve palsy who have no functioning flexor digitorum profundus tendon to the ring finger. Another example is the flexor carpi radialis muscle, which may be an appropriate transfer to provide finger extension in a manual laborer rather than the conventional flexor carpi ulnaris transfer, since the FCU provides the important function of flexion and ulnar deviation of the wrist needed in work activities such as hammering. Now we shall consider some of the secondary factors that should be considered when performing tendon transfers. The first is the innervation of the muscle that is going to be transferred. The donor muscle should be independently innervated and not act in concert with other motors, example, the lumbrical muscles. The next important secondary factor to be considered is the availability or necessity of antagonists. The brachioradialis is an effective wrist extensor only if the triceps is functioning to resist its normal elbow flexor action. The brachioradialis muscle crosses the elbow joint. If the triceps is not acting, any movement or contraction of the brachioradialis will first flex the elbow joint and will not act on the joint where it is expected to act, that is, when it is transferred as a wrist extensor. The third important factor when planning tendon transfers is to consider the use of appropriate arthrodesis. These can be done to provide good movements in the upper limb or to provide stable pinch grip. When our aim is to provide good movements in the upper limb, the use of radiocarpal arthrodesis, that is wrist arthrodesis, arthrodesis of the thumb carpometacarpal joint, and even glenohumeral arthrodesis can be considered. And when our aim is to provide a stable pinch grip, arthrodesis of the metacarpophalangeal joint and the interphalangeal joints of the thumb, and arthrodesis of the finger proximal interphalangeal joint and distal interphalangeal joint will play a big role. The tension of the transfer is also very important. All transfers should be sutured at the maximum tension in the position that reverses their proposed activity. In other words, the tension of suturing the transfer tendon is most important to decide the functional outcome. And lastly, a consideration of the sensibility of the skin. Normal skin sensibility is desirable, but we need to remember that it is not mandatory for doing a tendon transfer. It is important to achieve a good sensation, especially on the palmar aspect, for small object precision manipulations. But protective sensation is enough to achieve pinch, grasp, hook, and stabilizing hold down activities with tendon transfers. The biomechanical changes brought about by the transferred tendon is enough to prevent trophic ulcers on use of the hand. Now we come to the important point of deciding the timing of the tendon transfer. It basically depends on the etiology of the problem, the prognosis of the motor imbalance, the neurophysiological problems of the patient, and the constitution of the involved extremity. Generally, a tendon transfer is done after the skin cover, skeletal stability, achievement of sensation, achievement of passive joint mobility, and when there is no active disease process. Usually, tendon transfers are done at three different time periods. The first is called the conventional transfer, the second the early transfer, and the late transfers. Conventionally, tendon transfers are performed after the reinnervation of the paralyzed muscle fails to occur by 3 months after the expected time of reinnervation based on the rate of nerve regeneration of 1 mm per day. An example for this, if the median nerve repair has been done in the distal forearm about 6 cm proximal to the thumb, expected neurotization of the thenar muscles should occur by about 3 months. We can wait for another 3 months or confirm with nerve conduction studies and then proceed with tendon transfers if the reinnervation has not occurred. Tendon transfers can also be done in the early period. This was advocated by Brand, Omer and Burkhalter, who advocated early tendon transfers in certain circumstances. Tendon transfer is performed simultaneously with the nerve repair or before the expected time of reinnervation of the muscle. When the tendon transfer is done early, it can act as a splint during the regrowth of the nerve which has been repaired, and this will reduce the time of external splinting and improve early recovery. The transfer can act as a helper and add power to the normal reinnervated muscle function. And in case the result of the neurorefi is poor, the transfer can act as a substitute for the paralyzed muscle. So, early tendon transfers are advocated where the results of nerve surgery are expected to be poor. When there is a nerve gap of more than 4 cm, there is a large wound or excessive scarring and skin loss over the region of the nerve. Tendon transfers can also be done in the late period when patients present late after injury to the peripheral nerve, when the motor units are degenerated or significant soft tissue loss as in electrical burns. In this situation, skin reconstruction takes priority and must be completed before the nerve transfers are planned. Even in conditions of congenital anomalies like hypoplastic thumb, degenerative processes like rheumatoid arthritis, and spastic conditions like cerebral palsy, tendon transfers are done in a delayed time setting. Tendon transfers, though, can be done in all these time situations, we must remember that there are certain contraindications for tendon transfers. When there is a lack of suitable donors with grade 5 power, muscles that have been denervated and then reinnervated cannot be used as donors for tendon transfer. Individuals with progressive neuromuscular diseases and less than supple joints are relative contraindications. Once the decision has been taken to perform the tendon transfer, we need to concentrate on the details. We need to select the donor tendon, the route of transfer, the recipient insertion, and the stages of transfer. The process of selecting the donor muscle must be done very carefully. For example, in a case of high median nerve palsy, we need to list out the available muscles for transfer based on the principles that we have learned so far. And then we need to achieve each function specifically. For instance, to restore opposition, the use of the extensor indicis proprius and the extensor carpi ulnaris only will be ideal. The flexor digitorum superficialis and the palmaris longus would also have been involved in a high median nerve palsy. Once the donor muscle has been selected, we then need to select the route in which it is going to be transferred. We know that the straight line of pull is ideal, but it is not possible always. So we need to decide on where the pulley is going to be positioned. Taking the example of restoration of opposition in a case of median nerve palsy, the pulley can be distal in the line of the adductor pollicis muscle or proximal using the flexor carpi ulnaris pulley. We must remember that each pulley position will have a change or a biomechanical effect on the tendon transfer. In this example, the more distal the pulley, we get more of pronation of the thumb, and the more proximal the pulley, we get more of abduction of the thumb. So each patient must be thoroughly evaluated for deficit before the pulley can be sited. We have selected the donor muscle and decided how it is going to reach the insertion. The point of insertion can be modified by moving it away from the joint to improve the power, but this will be at the expense of excursion. As far as number of insertions is concerned, a single insertion is the best. Dual insertions tend to provide motion to the tighter insertion, but they can be an advantage in complex movements where one insertion is tighter during one phase of motion and the other takes over during another phase. Let us again consider the example of restoration of opposition in median nerve palsy. In Brand's technique, the insertion can be given to the abductor pollicis brevis and the extensor pollicis longus to correct the flexion deformity at the interphalangeal joint. It can also be given to the adductor pollicis to bring about some amount of adduction. This dual insertion is ideal when there is a combined median and ulnar nerve palsy. In the Littler's technique, there is an insertion only into the abductor pollicis brevis tendon. In the Riordan's technique, the donor tendon is woven into the abductor pollicis brevis and then inserted to the extensor pollicis longus. In the Bunnell's technique, the insertion is into the bone proper. In some situations, we may need to do multiple tendon transfers. The example of total claw of the hand, where there is both a median and ulnar nerve palsy, and we need to do both opponent's plasty and claw correction. So the final decision to be taken is whether both these tendon transfers are to be done together, or first the opponent's plasty is done and then the claw correction, or first the claw correction and then the opponent's plasty. So the sequence of tendon transfer in multiple tendon transfers must be decided. Surgeons can decide on any of these sequences based on their experience and expertise. But generally, first the claw correction is done and then the opponent's plasty, or both the opponent's plasty and the claw correction can be done together. And to maximize success in tendon transfer surgery, we need to remember a few points. The incisions should not cross the paths of the transferred tendons, and the stronger the insertion, the earlier can be the mobilization and better can be the results. The tendon, when it is inserted into bone, it should be done at 90 degrees. And if it is going to be a tendon-to-tendon suturing, a pulvertoft weave would be ideal and stronger. Rehabilitation plays an important role in tendon transfers in the preoperative phase and in the subsequent phases after the surgery. In the preoperative phase, passive mobilization of the joints to make them supple, scar massage and anti-edema measures, and strengthening of the muscle that is to be transferred must be concentrated on. The protective phase begins at surgery and lasts for about 3 to 5 weeks during the immobilization period, where edema control is the most important step. Once the POP is off, the mobilization phase begins when the tendon transfer is mobilized by reinforcing pre-operative teaching and patient education, and usually home rehabilitation program is begun with daytime dynamic splinting with night static splinting. The intermediate phase begins after 8 weeks and consists of consolidating the mobilization. And finally, the resistive phase to increase the endurance and strength of the transferred muscles and work-related simulated tasks are begun. I hope you enjoyed the video. I enjoyed making it. Please click on the shown links to see more about the techniques of nerve repair and reconstruction. And do not forget to subscribe to keep connected with the latest in learning hand surgery.